Infantile Spasms, Level Basic, Version Number 1, May 2012, by Dr. Matthew Robertson and Dr. William Gallantine. Affiliations, Division of Neurology, Duke University Medical Center. Learning objectives: to understand the history, etiology, clinical presentation, causes, treatment, and prognosis of infantile spasms, IS for short. Outline: we will discuss the history, epidemiology, etiology, clinical symptoms and presentation, causes, treatment, and prognosis related to infantile spasms. History of spasms. Infantile spasms were first described by William James West in 1841 in The Lancet. West was an English surgeon who was describing symptoms in his own son, James Edwin. West noted bobbings that cause a complete heaving of the head forward towards the knees and then immediately relaxing into an upright position. These bowings and relaxings would repeat alternately at intervals of few seconds and repeated from 10 to 20 or more times in each attack, which would not continue for more than 2 or 3 minutes. West syndrome became known as a triad of infantile spasms, arrest of psychomotor development, and hypsarrhythmia on EEG. Infantile spasms are also referred to as jackknife convulsions, massive myoclonia, or Salaam spasms. Infantile spasm epidemiology. Age of onset. The majority, up to 90% of affected children, present at less than 1 year of age, with a range from 1 day old to 4.5 years. The peak incidence of onset, 50 to 77%, is between 3 and 7 months of age. Onset after 18 months is rare. The true age of onset may be uncertain in infantile spasms, as they are commonly mistaken for other conditions. The incidence of infantile spasms is 1.6 to 4.5 per 10,000 live births. Inheritance patterns are highly variable and depend on the underlying cause of the spasms. There are certain established infantile spasm genetic patterns, including X-linked infantile spasms. Mutations in the aristolase-related homeobox, ARX gene, is associated with the familial syndrome of IS, severe mental retardation, and subsequent epilepsy. Etiology. Infantile spasms are classified as either symptomatic or cryptogenic based on whether an underlying etiology can be found. Cortical dysplasia is the most common cause of symptomatic infantile spasms, accounting for up to 30% of prenatal causes. 1 to 5% of children with Down syndrome will develop IS. Many inborn errors of metabolism are associated with infantile spasms. In countries where phenylketonuria, PKU, is not detected by newborn metabolic screening, IS is a common manifestation of this disorder. Dihydropteridine reductase deficiency, Menkes disease, cytochrome C oxidase deficiency, histidinemia, pyridoxine deficiency, and urea cycle disorders are other potential metabolic causes. Other CNS malformations that may result in infantile spasms include cerebral dysgenesis, as seen in Aicardi syndrome, lissencephaly, as in Miller-Dieker syndrome, which is seen in the gross axial section in the upper right picture, holoprosencephaly, as seen in the gross coronal section in the lower right picture, hemimegencephaly. Congenital infections such as toxoplasmosis, syphilis, cytomegalovirus are also potential causes. Perinatal injuries like hypoxic ischemic encephalopathy and neonatal hypoglycemia, as well as postnatal insults such as traumatic injury, near drowning, have also been implicated in the development of infantile spasms. Symptoms and presentation. There are three types of spasms. The first, termed flexor spasm, consists of a sudden flexion of the neck, trunk, arms, and legs, and contraction of the abdominal muscles. This contraction may be severe enough to cause the torso to jackknife at the waist. The second type of spasm, extensor spasms, consist of abrupt extension of the neck and trunk with abduction or adduction of the arms and legs. The third type of spasm, mixed flexor-extensor spasm, usually consists of flexion of the neck, trunk, and arms and extension of the legs. Less commonly, they involve flexion of the legs and extension of the arms. A fourth type of spasm, where there is marked asymmetry from side to side, can occur, typically in patients with focal brain lesions. The extent and intensity of seizures vary. The ictal event can range from a precipitous massive contraction to an evanescent contraction confined to the rectus abdominis muscles or a brief head nod. Deviation of the eyes or rhythmic nystagmoid eye movements occur in approximately 55% of seizures. Changes in respiratory pattern occur frequently during spasms. A cry or scream frequently occurs after an attack, but is not part of the seizure. 80% of spasms occur in clusters, consisting of 2 to 125 events at a rate of as many as 13 per minute. The intensity and frequency of spasms in each cluster often increase progressively to a peak and then decline until they stop. Different seizure types may occur within a cluster. The frequency of seizures is similar during the day and night. Clusters tend to occur following arousal rather than during sleep. Photic stimulation, handling, feeding, or loud sounds do not precipitate spasms, although they may appear to do so. This is an example of symmetric spasms. Note the equal involvement of both arms and both legs. This is an example of asymmetric spasms. Note the difference between the right and left during periods of flexion and abduction. This is usually caused by an underlying structural lesion.
She's not awake. So it's like, okay, the seizures are dampened, but her consciousness is dampened as well.
Differential diagnosis. Spasms have varied appearances and severities, and for that reason, a broad differential. Given such a large number of possible causes for abnormal movements in infants, the diagnosis of infantile spasms is often delayed. Other clinical entities to consider range from benign and transient to devastating. The differential includes colic, gastroesophageal reflux or Sandifer syndrome, excessive startles, exaggerated moral reflexes, repetitive body arching, spasticity, benign myoclonus of early infancy, benign neonatal sleep myoclonus, tonic reflex seizures of early infancy, benign and severe myoclonic epilepsies. Workup. The early diagnosis of infantile spasms rely heavily on searching for an underlying cause of the spasms and ancillary testing to rule out other potential diagnoses. Magnetic resonance imaging, MRI, is useful for detecting cerebral malformations, cerebral atrophy, delayed myelination, and focal lesions, especially cortico-subcortical lesions. Electroencephalography, EEG, is essential to identify the pathognomonic brainwave pattern seen in IS called hypsarrhythmia. This pattern consists of high-voltage, random, slow waves and spikes in all cortical areas that vary in duration and location, and appear to originate from one part of the cortex at one moment, then from another or from multiple foci a few seconds later. Hypsarrhythmia suggests near total disorganization of cortical voltage and regulation. A fairly comprehensive metabolic assessment is undertaken to search for a cause. This includes a pyridoxine challenge, urine for organic acids, serum for amino acids, and a biotinidase determination. Cerebrospinal fluid analysis is undertaken to look for specific neurotransmitters, lactic acid, amino acids, folate metabolites, glucose, and glycine. Chromosomal studies can also be useful in identifying an underlying genetic cause or syndrome. Positron emission computed tomography, PET scan, is also used at some institutions to identify specific metabolically abnormal parts of the brain. Treatment. The mainstay of treatment for infantile spasms is with ACTH. Dosing at 150 units per meter squared has been shown to cause cessation of spasms in anywhere between 42 and 87% of infants. The average time from initiation of treatment to cessation of spasms is typically 7 to 12 days. In general, response to ACTH is greater for infants with cryptogenic IS than for infants with symptomatic infantile spasms. Relapse rates range from 15 to 33%. Side effects that are common with ACTH treatment include hyperglycemia and hypertension. Treatment continued. The ketogenic diet has been used both as a first-line therapy and in cases of ACTH failure. While it may be an effective treatment, it requires significant dietary modification and monitoring, which is often challenging, especially in infants and toddlers. Other antiepileptics are also used to treat infantile spasms, typically as second-line agents. Studies have shown that Topamax and Zonegran, as well as Depakote, may help reduce spasm frequency. Vigabatrin, which is an irreversible inhibitor of GABA transaminase, is another potential AED. It has been shown to be especially efficacious in patients with tuberous sclerosis. However, treatment with vigabatrin must be closely monitored, as patients may develop irreversible peripheral vision loss. Prognosis. Overall prognosis for children with infantile spasms is poor. The overall mortality rate is as high as 33%, but morbidity is much higher. Clinical spasms stop by 3 years of age in approximately one-half of children with IS and rarely persist after 5 years of age. Hips arrhythmia also tends to resolve with maturation. Overall, 50 to 90% of patients with infantile spasms develop other seizure types, and up to half of patients with IS will develop Lennox-Gastaut syndrome. Seizure outcomes are more favorable in cryptogenic versus symptomatic infantile spasms, and in those with earlier onset of their spasms. Developmental retardation occurs in approximately 85% of patients with infantile spasms. There is little information available on very long-term outcome of children with IS. Some adults with a history of IS have normal intelligence and socioeconomic status. In a recent study, intelligence was normal or only mildly impaired in 24% of survivors of IS, and 33% had no seizures. Some patients with normal intelligence and socioeconomic status had symptomatic IS or focal EEG findings. All patients with a good outcome had short delays between presentation and treatment and responded to ACTH therapy. In summary, infantile spasms typically manifest early in life at less than 1 year of age. Spasms may be difficult to diagnose clinically due to a wide spectrum of spasm appearances and confounding diseases within the differential diagnosis. Hips arrhythmia on EEG is pathognomonic, and a workup for an underlying cause must include structural, infectious, genetic, and metabolic causes. Treatment involves ACTH, AEDs such as Topamax and Vigabatrin, and the ketogenic diet. Prognosis is poor, especially in symptomatic infantile spasms.